It only happens with Depeche Mode, but I get hung up in a good way with certain songs. And as of late, it has been Poison Heart. I love that song. I adore that song. I love everything about that song. How beefy it is. I don't know if it's the drum. I don't know if it's the bass. I don't know what it is, but just that slamming that takes place, the lyrical content of it. And it got me thinking. Welcome to the podcast, by the way. I'm your host, Jon Justice. I think it's episode 16? Usually I write it down in front of me because I end up forgetting. I think it is. Oh, hold on. Since I'm in the middle of this now, I might as well go ahead and look to make sure I get it right. No, we're episode 17. Sorry. Episode 17 of the podcast. But the funny thing is that with thinking about the podcast and what we're going to cover this week and starting it off by talking about Poison Heart, I began to come to the realization that over the course of the last two albums, all of my favorite songs are Dave Gahan written tracks. And I haven't put my finger on it. Maybe it's nothing. Maybe it's Dave coming into his own as a songwriter and tapping into the lyrical content, because he is coming into his own as a songwriter way later than, say, what Martin Gore did. So, theory. This is just a theory, and just roll with me on it. So, Martin Gore, early on in his career, he wrote some, he had love songs in there, you know, some songs about faith and devotion, and we're going to be talking about that on the podcast today. But, you know, he had songs that had other content, social commentary attached to it. And, you know, and then later on, as you get into Some Great Reward and Music for the Masses and certainly Violator and Black Celebration and Songs of Faith and Devotion, you have deeper lyrical content and the a little bit more spiritual, a little bit more emotional. And I'm not a songwriter, but I imagine that as your success grows, your confidence level grows, and your ability to craft a song gets better, and maybe Dave's just been going through that. Maybe it's just the process of becoming a songwriter through writing song for the past couple of albums and having two solo records and spending more time with the material. And, you know, the fact that he worked with Gordino and Christian Eigner on not just Poison Heart, but also Cover Me, which are two of my favorite songs on the album, of Spirit. You going back to the last album and Broken, my favorite song off that album. And I just, when, again, talking about opening up and discussing Poison Heart, it immediately became clear that I was like, oh, hey, you know what? All of the songs that I really like of the band, as of late, my favorite ones are Dave Gahan tracks. So I just, again, my theory could be completely wrong. It could just be circumstance. But Dave is getting better as a songwriter. And, you know, perhaps it's the combo. I mean, when you look at Cover Me with Gordino and Eigner, you know, Gordino seems like a dude to me. I know very little about Peter Gordino. But for some reason, I just get a vibe off of him that obviously he's good musically, but I think there's some depth there. The little bit of interviews that I've seen with him, he seems like a no-nonsense kind of guy. And I imagine that his contributions to Dave Gahan tracks are pretty significant. So I just, man, Poison Heart, that song just sounds so good in my car when I'm cranking it. So thanks for checking out the podcast this week. I'm glad that you're with us. Gonna run through half of the bracket today. Probably not gonna get into any email this week, just because I know I normally say that and then I don't. So this week I'm gonna focus just on the few topics that I have written down here in front of me, and then friend of the show, John, J-O-H-N, Justice, had put together that amazing Depeche Mode bracket. And as I filled out, I've got the whole thing done. And I'm going to talk about his picks next week. I'm just going to work through the first half of my bracket, and then next week I'll do the second half and talk about his and some of the other ones that I have received. And again, you can email talkshownerd@gmail.com. As I was working through the bracket, I realized, yeah, I'm going to have to go half and half on the podcast because I could wipe out in my explanation as to why I chose particular songs over other songs. So let's start here, and this is just more of a personal story. I host a radio show, for those that don't know, but I host a radio show Monday through Friday on Twin Cities News Talk here in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And it's Justice and Drew, the guy I work with, Drew Lee. He hired me back in 2007 when I worked in Tucson, left 3 years later to come up here to be the program director of this radio station. And then after 9 years of me being in Tucson, we really wanted to work together again and finally were able to make it happen. And so he hired me up here and now we do the show together. With Drew is our producer, Samantha, who I have introduced Depeche Mode 2 because she just turned 21 and hadn't really been exposed to it. Not really a fan yet. I don't think she's really embraced it. I haven't spent a ton of time on it. We do post show podcasts, and we spent one podcast talking about the Smiths, which was kind of fun. Haven't done one with Depeche Mode. Drew's not a huge fan, so you know we use some DM for bumper music, but all of this is to say that we're three very unique characters, and you probably will not be surprised to know that I wear my heart on my sleeve. I kind of just put it all out there. And because of that, if I'm being honest, it leaves me open a lot of time. And a lot of people like to have sort of fun at my expense. And I want to make sure I word this correctly because I know it sounds weird. I mean, people have a tendency to, I don't want to say pick on me, but give me a hard time. And it's been that way my entire life. I get along with a lot of people, and that's not to say people don't, it's not to say that people don't like me and so they do that. No, that's just their personality. I'm not like that. I'm not one to really get off on, you know, I'm sarcastic, and I can be, but not at my friends. And for some reason, I end up surrounding myself around people that tend to be sarcastic towards me because I leave myself so open and vulnerable. And I would like to believe it's because of their own insecurities, because they're not comfortable enough in their own skin to leave it all out there like I do. So all of this is to say that I had brought up, we were talking about the podcasts that I do, and discussing the number of downloads and stuff like that, and how I never would have thought that of the Star Wars, the NASCAR, and the Depeche Mode podcast, that Depeche Mode would be the one that gets the most downloads. I just didn't anticipate that, but it turns out to be true. Now, that being said, there's not a lot of Depeche Mode podcasts out there. I think there's one other one, and there's a ton of Star Wars ones, and NASCAR's a very selective group, and I don't think the majority of NASCAR fans really do a lot of with podcasting. So, be that as it may, we were talking about some stuff, and they know what an emotional guy I am, and I had made a comment about growing up, and I always refer to the 90s, late 80s, and throughout most of the 90s as the dark years, just of me being alone and dating and, you know, and all that. So, you know, I mentioned how during the dark years, doing that thing with my fingers, you know, Depeche Mode was my best friend. And I talked about this in the podcast. I think I almost did a whole podcast on that very thing. It was just so funny because they gave me such a ration of crap for it. Such a hard time. Oh, that's just sad that you'd say that. And for me, it's not. It never has been. I guess from the outside looking in, if you don't have that type of relationship with anything in your life that really touches you and grabs you and hits you on an emotional level, you're not going to be able to relate. And so there's a saying, which I don't like using that often because if you apply it to my show, then it doesn't work as well. But there's a saying that we mock what we don't understand, right? And I mock a lot of stuff that I do understand. But I also think there is a little bit of truth in that sometimes we mock what we don't understand. And if you have an individual who hasn't been touched by a group, And it's certainly, we Depeche Mode fans aren't the first ones to be emotionally attached to a group of individuals or a creative team. We are a special brand, however, of, you know, I mean, when you look at Cure fans or, I could rattle off a list, right? But if you're not, and both of these individuals, I don't think have that. I don't think there's any band that really, like, Drew is a big fan of Southern culture on the skids. But I don't think he's gravitating towards it to serve a sort of an emotional need, right? We do that with Depeche Mode. That's what Depeche Mode does for us. And so I wanted to share that with you because this is the place where I can share that. And in sharing that with you, I'd like to believe that there are those of you that have gone through the same thing. It's funny, though, because anybody that knows me knows if something about Depeche Mode pops up in mainstream media to where they see it, they come to me. It gets posted on my timeline. Somebody make a comment. If anybody sees Depeche Mode out in the world, they are going to think Jon Justice if they're friends with me. That's just how it is. And I don't mind the ribbing because I've put it out there. I've told people about it. And that's probably why I have people give me a hard time, because I put out a lot that most people probably keep private. Maybe I needed to just keep my trap shut most of the time. But again, I just wanted to share that with you, because if anybody is going to be able to relate to that, it is going to be you, my fellow Depeche Mode fan. All right, so I may be going to see them live. I think I finally figured it out. I'm going to attempt, or at least I've been talking about it, and I keep going back and forth. But my wife and my kids are visiting Tucson at the end of August. And the weekend they come back, on Saturday. Oh, I've looked at the calendar. I think it's like the 27th or something like that, or maybe the 28th. They come back that night, a Saturday night. The Friday before that, the band is playing their second or third night of the U.S. tour in Denver. And it looks like I can, after my show is done Friday, maybe catch a flight to Denver to watch the show that night and then fly back first thing on Saturday morning. So at the moment, that's what I'm looking at. And again, I keep having to go back and forth just because of finances, and I have to, unfortunately... and this is actually Depeche Mode related. I have to unfortunately have two wisdom teeth pulled on Wednesday. And I've created a playlist, a Depeche Mode playlist, to listen to when they pull my teeth. My wife Melinda had to have three wisdom teeth pulled a couple of weeks back. And she can drive. It's outpatient, obviously. She can drive, maybe not obviously, but it's outpatient. So she, you know, I can drive to get my wisdom teeth pulled, but they're going to put me under laughing gas. And keep me awake during the process, kind of get me high. And then once the procedure's over, it'll have worn off, and then I'll come home. So she made herself a playlist for the procedure, and I decided I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing. So again, because of finances and the amount of money that's going to unfortunately cost, I'm still debating. But that's my plan at the moment. I'm hoping that Denver... will be the place where I can go see the show live. And because of that, I've decided to start ignoring any videos of the show. I've watched the whole show in some way, shape, or form now online. But I've decided, you know what, if I'm going to see him live, I'm going to go ahead and put some distance between me and the live show. That way I can see it with the freshest eyes possible. And the good news is that in the off chance, and I don't know, I'd have to go back and look to see how often they change the set list from Europe to America. I think, unfortunately, usually when they start touring the States, they cut down on the set list. That being said, the nice thing is they're only playing a couple of nights in America before that Denver show. So if I'm able to go to that Denver show, it's easy for me to avoid whatever the set list is and go in with the freshest eyes possible. And I remember, I think I've told the story before, but I remember the first night I saw the Songs of Faith and Devotion tour in San Jose, what an amazing experience it was just watching the show play out and hearing the opening notes of the song and the remixes and taking a moment and trying to figure out what song it was. And then that that moment, that amazing moment when the song hits and you realize, ah, I know that song. It's Walking in My Shoes. You know, this kind of thing. And that's just so much fun. When you see the show live, not knowing what songs they were going to play, and then they play the song, and it's like, yeah, they're playing that one. And tough to do nowadays because set lists are available. You can see, I mean, you can watch it play out live. They put everything up on YouTube. So the hope is, if I go to Denver, to keep everything as fresh in my, you know, as fresh as possible, and try to put a distance on all of that. So currently, that is the plan. And hey, if you're going to the Denver show, if you're in Denver and you're listening to this podcast, drop me an email, talkshownerd@gmail.com. Maybe that'll help sort of solidify my plans. It'd be amazing. It would be absolutely amazing if I were able to hook up, because I'm probably going to be going alone. It would be absolutely amazing if I were able to hook up with anybody who lives in Denver or is going to the Denver show when I went to the show. And if we were able to do some kind of a meeting at the concert, that would be great, and certainly would be even more motivation to spend the money to get out to that show. So again, talkshownerd@gmail.com. If you are going to the Denver show, let me know, because that would be absolutely, that would be just fantastic. All right, on to a bit of news this week. It has been I don't want to, but announced that Going Backwards is going to be the second single from Spirit. I have yet to see any track listings of what we can expect in terms of, are we going to get B-sides? Are we going, well, no, what are the remixes going to be? And I went ahead and popped on to Depeche-Mode.com to see if anybody had put anything new up, and nobody has. The only thing, basically, is that the second single is going to be Going Backwards. A few days ago, somebody wrote, I heard a radio edit version of Going Backwards on my local radio station. And Going Backwards was said by Martin in an interview that it was never regarded to be a single. Let's see. But considering what Dave said about them not having any idea what song was going to be the next single, they might as well go for the obvious choice. It's got Fletch's vote, at least. It is an interesting choice, but singles don't mean nearly as much, right, as they do. When I look at what could be a single on the album, I would point to Cover Me, but then I go, no, because the end of that, you'd have to do an edited version and trim down the end of the song. I don't think that works for radio play. Poison Heart, I think, could be. It's short enough, 3:17. I think the most accessible song off Spirit for a second single could be No More, This Is the Last Time. Well, okay, I'm sorry. The obvious choice, I'm looking at the track list here. I got to back up. The obvious choice is So Much Love. That's the obvious choice for a single from the album. But Going Backwards is a good choice. It's long, so they would have to do a radio edit. I'd be curious to see what they sounded like. And I'd love to see a video for that song. And probably my... trying to look. Looking at the track list. Poor Man, So Much Love. Yeah, I would say of the Martin Gore written tracks on the album, Going Backwards and Where's the Revolution are my favorite. So, you know, Poison Heart, Cover Me, No More, This Is the Last Time, Going Backwards, Where's the Revolution, just looking at the track list, probably the order I would put it in terms of the songs that are my favorite on the album. I want some B-sides, though. I'm clamoring for some B-sides. I'd like to know what didn't make it onto the album. I know that they said that there wasn't going to be a lot of B-sides. I think at least I remember that's what they were saying. There wouldn't be a ton of B-sides from the album because they put pretty much everything on there, and that James Ford, the producer, wanted to trim back and have it be a 10-track album, and so they pushed him to add two, or was it three songs? I think it was probably 9 or 10 tracks. But I would love to hear what some of the B-sides are. From the standpoint that the album is fairly unconventional, so I'd be curious to know what the B-sides sounded like that didn't make it on the album. Like, I thought the B-sides for Delta Machine were rather interesting. Not a huge fan of those of those B-sides, to be honest. I mean, there's a couple of good ones in there, but none of them were very, sort of accessible, if that's the term that I want to use. Let me take a look here real quick. Yeah, so when you look at the, let me go here. Yeah, when you look at the B-sides for Delta Machine, as opposed to Sounds of the Universe, so Sounds of the Universe with Ghost and Light, those songs could have easily ended up on the album, in my opinion. But when you look at the B-sides to Delta Machine, Long Time Lie, Happens All the Time, I like that song a lot. Always, All That's Mine Has Grown on Me. I spent a lot of time on that because that was the B-side to Heaven, and I actually liked All That's Mine more. I mean, I liked Heaven, but I thought it was boring. I liked All That's Mine better. What's interesting about those four B-sides to Delta Machine, though, is that they sound very similar, in my opinion, to what we got on Spirit. But none of them had were really catchy by any stretch. And I completely agreed with keeping them off of the album. There's a couple of tracks I maybe would have traded for Happens All the Time, because that's one that I go back to quite a lot. So, all that is to say, I'd love to know what B-sides there are, and hopefully we get a B-side or two. That would be, but I haven't seen any indication whatsoever that's the plan. The only other thing I'll mention about Going Backwards being the second single is that apparently it's going to be a digital-only release. There's not going to be a physical version of that, which is really going to suck for completists. I used to be a completist. I'm not anymore. I'll get the album. A hard copy of the album every time. But I used to be I was a completist up until Exciter. I think Exciter was the last album where I stopped getting physical releases for all the singles. And that was partly due to the fact that shortly after that, I stopped working in music radio. So it was a little bit more difficult, meaning I had to go out and purchase this stuff. So, yeah, that would really be a bummer for those of you listening that are completists if you don't get a physical copy. But that being said, I would imagine if you are a completist and want a physical release for everything that came out as a physical release, it doesn't mean it's incomplete because they didn't release Going Backwards if they don't as a physical release. So there's nothing to if you get everything. I think that makes sense. That works, right? There's nothing to get if you get everything. If you're a complete, yeah. You know what? Let's just move on. All right. Sorry, I got excited. I hit the keyboard. Let's get to the bracket. Okay, we're just gonna do one half. All right. So if you have your bracket, get it out now. If you don't, shame on you. Go to go to the Podbean page and look back on, episode 15, right? Is that what it was? Episode 15 was the one where I originally posted John John Justice's. I'm just going to pull, I have it readily available. Hey, I'm good. Yes, episode 15 of Unselected Cases. I'm looking at the bracket right now. If you don't have it, you can still play along in your mind as you listen, but I'm going to go through half. So I'm going to give you the first half of the bracket. I'm going to work off the left half, and then next week we'll do the right half. Send me your picks, and we'll see if you match up with mine, talkshownerd@gmail.com. All right, so let's go through here. First up, we've got Enjoy the Silence versus Dressed in Black. Are we going to do Seeds here? No, I don't think we're doing Seeds, because I think the Seeds on this were based solely off of the original college basketball tournament bracket. So I'm going to ignore the Seeds, and I'm going to stick specifically with track versus track. So first choice was Enjoy the Silence versus Dressed in Black. That was an easy pick. I went with Enjoy the Silence. I like Dressed in Black, but Enjoy the Silence is classic. That one is always going to hold a special place in my heart, not just because of how amazing the song is, and it is an amazing song. Cover Me feels like a sister, like a companion song to that, for no good reason. It's just those two songs for some reason. If you ever listen to them back to back, do that, because they actually do go really well together. But Enjoy the Silence, I remember hearing the original minimalist version, because if I'm not mistaken, that version, which was sort of the Martin Gore demo, the really slow version of Enjoy the Silence with the organ, came out on the release, the physical release of Personal Jesus. So I remember hearing that version first and really liking it. I could be, man, maybe it didn't. Maybe it came out with, I don't have time to go look at my collection right now, but maybe it was on the single for Enjoy the Silence. I'm trying to, no. Okay, hold on. Okay, let me back up. I'm totally wrong here. So it goes like this. I heard the acoustic version of Personal Jesus first. Then I heard the produced album version and was blown away by what they did with the song. I remember listening to it with headphones, living in Santa Ana, California. Heard the acoustic version, thought it was great, then heard the fully produced version and was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. It went the other way with Enjoy the Silence. Heard Enjoy the Silence, loved the song, then heard the minimalist version and thought that was cool too. Either way, that snapshot moment in time rockets Enjoy the Silence to the top of the list. So up against a song like Dressed in Black, that's an easy, easy win. All right. So next pick, we've got Soothe My Soul versus Black Celebration. That was pretty easy too. I went with Black Celebration. Soothe My Soul is an okay track, but certainly nowhere near Black Celebration. Moving back down the list... And then we'll have to. I'm trying to figure out how I want to do this. Yeah, so we'll go down the list of the first rounds, and then we'll go to the next round, and we'll tell you who won between the two. So, moving down the list. Question of Time versus Things You Said. I ended up going with Things You Said on that. I like Question of Time, but again, it's not a go-to. And so, of the two, I feel that Things You Said is a stronger choice. Also, with that, in this round, It's No Good versus Sun and the Rainfall. That was a tough one. I do like It's No Good quite a bit. Kind of falls into that Soothe My Soul Question of Time category. Those songs, similar in beats per minute and vibe. Sun and the Rainfall, though, you got to give some love to the older tracks. And Sun and the Rainfall is a very special song, in my opinion. So between the two, tough choice, but I ended up going with Sun and the Rainfall over It's No Good. Moving back down the list, Question of Lust versus Sacred. Easy, Question of Lust, hands down, not a problem. Shake the Disease, a pain that I'm used to. This was tough. Tough from the standpoint of the easy win goes to, or the easy pick goes to Shake the Disease. But it's a bummer that I had to let go of Pain That I'm Used To because I love that song. So that was unfortunate. But I didn't put this together. John J.O.H. And Justice did. So if you have to choose, and I did, I go with Shake the Disease. All right. Dream On, Get the Balance Right. Another kind of tough one, but got to give some love to the older tracks, especially in the era of Leave in Silence and Get the Balance Right. So I went with Get the Balance Right. In Your Room, John the Revelator, no question. In Your Room, hands down, easy. Let's move on. Just Can't Get Enough, Fly on the Windscreen. Fly on the Windscreen. I respect Just Can't Get Enough for its popularity and what it did for the band's popularity. But if we're talking about overall song quality, which is how I am judging this, Fly on the Windscreen is going to win that one hands down. Only When I Lose Myself, Blasphemous Rumors. Another tough one. I love Only When I Lose Myself. I think it's a really strong Martin Gore written song. But Blasphemous Rumors, again, got to respect the old ones. Got to respect what came before. So, yes, I'm going to roll with Blasphemous Rumors. All right, moving on. Behind the Wheel and Home. Home wins, hands down, no question, done. Played that song as the song that my wife and I danced to at our wedding. Love Behind the Wheel. Really love Behind the Wheel, but if you're going to put it up against Home, Home's going to take it every time. Master and Servant versus Dangerous. Dangerous. I like Master and Servant, but it's not a go-to song for me by any stretch. Kind of falls into a People Are People category. Understand why it's a single. Understand why it's a huge hit. But I'll take a B-side of Dangerous any day of the week. Moving on. But Not Tonight and Wrong. That was kind of tough, but I went with But Not Tonight. Just because I love that song so much. Wrong is the stronger lyrically. Wrong is the stronger song as a whole. So I guess my whole idea of picking the strongest tracks goes out the window. Personal preference. Personal preference, I'm going with But Not Tonight. Precious versus I Want You Now. Man, I put Precious down. But looking at this a second time, I probably should have gone with I Want You Now. Although when you get to the next round, it doesn't matter because it's up against But Not Tonight, and that's going to win. So we'll just go with Precious. That was my initial thought. Heaven versus Here Is the House. Don't even need to question. That's Here Is a House. Hands down. Done. Strange Love and Clean. I went with Clean. Once again, I love Strange Love. Respect what it did for the fandom and why it was a popular song. But if I have to choose between the two, nope, I'm going with Clean. All right, so thus concludes round one. Let's move on to the second round of the first half of the bracket. All right, so kicking things off, Enjoy the Silence versus, where are we now? Sun and the Rainfall. That was very easy. The win between Enjoy the Silence and the Sun and the Rainfall will go to Enjoy the Silence. In round two, we have Shake the Disease versus In Your Room. That's tough. Not fair for In Your Room. In Your Room is an amazing, is an absolutely amazing song. But Shake the Disease is just means too much to me. Too much to my heart. Can't let it go. So, in round two, Shake the Disease versus In Your Room, the win goes to Shake the Disease. All right, moving on. Fly on the Windscreen versus Home. That one's easy. The winner goes to Home. And this is the one. Speaking of heart, this is the one that, hey, by the way, it's called A Heart's Not On Here. What's that about? Quick side note. Okay, let me write this down. I want to tell you a quick story about It's Called A Heart Here real quick. It's called A Heart. All right. So let me get to the second round first, and I'll tell my story, and then we'll go down to the final two rounds. This one broke my heart, and because you had to put Here Is the House up against But Not Tonight. And I love But Not Tonight, but Here Is the House, I've already gone on and on because it's true about how much I love that song and how it is my favorite Depeche Mode song ever, which tells you where this whole bracket is going. Spoiler alert. So with that, Here's the House wins over But Not Tonight. All right, so here's my little story about It's Called a Heart. This isn't that great. It just makes me laugh. So that song is, I don't know if you know this or not, but that song is pretty famous from the standpoint of how much the band hates it. If you've seen previous interviews where they talk about It's Called the Heart, they always rip on that song. I like the song. I understand why the band rips on it. It took special meaning. It took a special meaning on for me when I, and I'm pretty sure I've told this on the show before, so it's tough. When you end up doing these podcasts, I don't know how much I've covered, how much ground I've covered, and how much I haven't. And I probably, if I did talk about this, it was probably on an early episode. But I've had two open hearts. I'm 44. I've had two open heart surgeries. Had a heart attack back in 2009. I had a defective heart valve. My aortic valve was two flaps instead of three. And then I had an ascending aortic aneurysm, which means it had blown up. It was really big. So they had to give me a new valve, they had to put a graft in, and then that sprung a leak a couple years later, and I had to go back in and do it again. So when it comes to things as it relates to the heart, it's special for me. Depeche Mode is special for me, so having a song called It's Called a Heart, it takes on special meaning. It's just funny that, like, the song that zeroes in on the heart stuff the most is one that the band kind of, you know, hates the most. All right. So we are down two, where are we, round three? Yeah, so we'll get down, again, this is just the left side of the bracket. So first off, we have Enjoy the Silence versus Shake the Disease. Both amazing songs. It's unfortunate that I can only pick one, but I can only pick one, and the one that I'm going with is Shake the Disease. Okay, that was funny because I ended up using the ding from Enjoy the Silence to announce that Shake the Disease was the winner. All right, so again, moving on, we have Home versus Here's the House. And while I love my wife dearly and Home was the song that we played at our wedding and is our favorite song together, unfortunately, it cannot compete with Here Is the House. So it's Here Is the House winning over Home. And in the final round, before we head to the final, this is the last round, the final two, I guess I didn't do Final Four on that. That was kind of the whole point, wasn't it? Sorry, John. Shake the Disease versus Here Is the House. Again, two of my favorite Depeche Mode songs ever. But if I were stuck on an island and I were only able to listen to one, unfortunately, it would have to be... Well, I would have to put aside Shake the Disease, and the winner would be Here Is the House. So... make sure that you tune in next week to find out who Here Is the House is going up against. So let me, I'm just going to glance over this really quick because I am curious to see. Yes. So Here Is the House is my favorite Depeche Mode song. So, but I also want to keep an open mind on this. And I'm looking at the list on the right, from the right side of the bracket. And there are... There are some songs on here that could compete depending on my mood. I'm looking at one in particular that has really... I've always loved, but it has become increasingly more important in my Depeche Mode listening habits. That, because, you know, these songs replace themselves. I don't know if you're like me, but... I mean, I have, for a long time, Here Is the House has been my favorite, and if you ask me, that is my favorite, but it has competed with songs like Shake the Disease, and a few of the songs on the right side of the bracket list. So, I'm not going to say up front until I have a chance to go through it, to share it with you, okay? Because, let me, and you're probably scratching your head, I haven't gone and picked my champion yet, okay? And I'm gonna look at this again to make sure and go over it one more time and maybe adjust it since you haven't seen it. I am looking at the final two. I do have two songs here, and those two songs are gonna take some discussion to find out which one's gonna win. But I'm looking at the bracket again, and I'm gonna have to spend some more time and think about it because I'm looking at a couple of songs on here that may need a second look. So I'm glad that I waited to do the second round. I'm going to give this another once over before next week's show. But at the moment, into the final round is Here's the House. Make sure that you tune in next week to find out who the challenger to that particular song is. And again, talkshownerd@gmail.com. Send me your picks. And I'll go over, again, the other picks that I've received so far. All right, let's move on. At some point, I do plan on going through and spending a podcast talking about particular albums. Just, you know, this will be the Speak and Spell podcast, and this will be the Violator podcast. But I wanted to take, I was thinking about what I wanted to cover on the show this week, just in terms of topic. And where were we at? Oh, I went out to a dinner. We went out to this gala at the University of Minnesota for this speaker, Charles Murray. He wrote The Bell Curve. And really, really great speech that he gave in front of the crowd. And I was listening to Spirit on the way out, and I was listening to it on the way home. And there was some convergence going on between what Charles Murray was saying. And he got on the topic of culture. And philosophers and Shakespeare talking about how college students now aren't required to take Shakespeare. And he thought that that was very unfortunate. And talking about philosophers like Aristotle. And Depeche Mode did come into mind. And it came into mind because, not to say that Dave Gahan or Martin Gore, I'm not going to put them up on a higher pedestal saying that they're philosophers by any stretch, but when we talk about the things that impact our lives, poetry, you know, the writings of Shakespeare, great authors, right? The Bible, you can put other things into those categories, and we're all different, and I would put Depeche Mode into those categories. The impact that Depeche Mode has had on me, Martin Gore's writing in particular, and now to a certain extent Dave's. I will say that as we continue to talk about this, and as I mentioned at the beginning part of the show, I don't think that Dave has reached a level of... he hasn't reached the level of songwriter that Martin has yet, by any stretch. A couple of songs, maybe, but just there's a... Martin's got a depth. A song like Home, right? And it depends on the song, right? A song like Home, a song like Walking in My Shoes, right? A song like Judas. I'm actually looking at the track list right now for Songs of Faith and Devotion. Look, there's some really great writing. I mean, just amazing writing going on there. And so I just wanted to take a moment, and we have a few minutes left in the show, and I wanted to talk about Songs of Faith and Devotion. And I will spend an entire podcast at some point down the line talking about and going down Songs of Faith and Devotion track by track by track. That being said, that album's really special. I'm not going to say that it's the best album that they've done or it's my favorite one. It's certainly up there, and I've talked about that, but that album is really, really special. It is incredibly unique. Regardless of where it stands on the list of your favorite Depeche Mode albums, it is an amazing album and really sets itself apart. There is a depth, and I use this word thickness again, and it's funny, I use that word thickness, but it keeps bringing me back to the song Nostalgia by Mirror. If you haven't heard it, that's the one that Dave Gahan sings, and I'll just remind you again, if you have not gone out and found the song, the group is Mirror, Dave Gahan does the vocals, the song's called Nostalgia, and he uses the word thickness in that song, and it works really well. But there is a depth to that album. And it's not just in the songwriting. It's in the songwriting, but it's not just that. It's in the music, it's in the vocal performance, and it's in the creative process that made that album. It's one of the most fascinating stories, and I've read countless articles, watch the documentaries on Songs of Faith and Devotion. I have almost every single article written about that album released from that time. Again, talking about being a completist. I was a completist back then when it came to collecting all the articles on these albums. And that is a really special standout album. And while it may not be my favorite Depeche Mode album, it deserves its place, in my opinion, in rock and roll history of most important albums, right? I probably will have people that'll get upset with me for saying this, but you talk about the Beatles' White Album, yeah, I put Songs of Faith and Devotion in that category of just an amazing, stellar piece of creation, right? Because that's what it is. It is a creation. All right, we're down to a minute. Thank you so much for checking out the podcast again this week. And find it, Spreaker, Stitcher, Podbean, YouTube, iTunes, email me, talkshownerd@gmail.com. Enjoy your week in the world we live in and life in general. And I will talk to you again next week. Bye.
My Nerd World.